Is it what crazy? Or tall crazy? Or what type of crazy is that? Except crazy.
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, changing looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face.
Excuse me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our military to this recruit. I said to hell
on Cold Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we'll bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.
And as sun begins to set on the honeymoon of the president of Nigeria, who is about more than 5 months into his administration, Nigerians are talking and reacting to what they think of this certain administration. And that's why we're looking at this topic, Project Nigeria, the new dispensation on check. And I'm discussing this particular topic with me, two fine gentlemen. I have Femi Okunrunmu, a health statesman. He was a senator representing Ogun Central, and he actually was in office from May 29, 1999 to May 29, 2003. And so he's here with me in the studio to discuss Project Nigeria. Good morning. It's nice having you.
Good morning.
Yes, and I also have a legal practitioner, Edward Ayo Dugbeson, who has also held some leadership positions in Nigeria. So it's really nice having you both on set today. Now, I'll start with you, Senator Okunrunmu. You said far back as 2013 that the problem of Nigeria and Nigerians is that of leadership. Is that still our problem today?
It remains the biggest problem. It's not the only problem, but it's, if you solve the problem of leadership, all other problems will more or less be solved. So our problem, the greatest problem is that of leadership.
And so what do you think of this administration's approach to governance and leadership?
Well, I think everybody had very high hopes in President Buhari. And that is why Nigeria voted for him. But it appears he has not been living up to the expectations of most of those people who voted for him. It appears it did not have a comprehensive agenda in terms of an economic plan, you know, a plan for education, for agriculture, and for all the various aspects of governance. It did not have concrete plans about what he was going to do before he got there. And up to now, it appears he's still groping in the dark. He has no concrete agenda for the economy, for instance.
Okay. And let me take the legal practitioner. Only recently, with the statement the president made that Nigeria is broke, and that's the past administration actually ran the country dry. And we also saw a quick reaction by the People's Democratic Party saying that the president should really not be making such statement. Now, what is your take on this certain issue?
Well, thank you. I think at this point in time, 5 months down the line, going to six, for the president to come around and say, oh, Nigeria is broke, they won't go me around. I think it's, I'm not talking politically now, I'm being realistic. I think it's unacceptable. Unacceptable in the sense that before you came into power, you knew the problems of Nigeria. You made them your campaign issues. And after election, there are some months before your inauguration, you had your transitional working committees. They gave you a blueprint. They're supposed to give you a blueprint into how to run the government, your government, when you are sworn in. And now having been sworn in, to now say you just realized that, did the former government, did they go take all the oil blocks away? Did they ask the international community not to buy oil from Nigeria? Did they take, you see, government is a going, it's a continuum, it's a going concern. You know, when you're there, you made some promises. You promised change. Nigerians voted for that change. And almost 6 months down the lane, you are still finding excuses. I think it's unacceptable. And I think it just shows that perhaps the APC government, a conglomeration of diverse interests just to capture power, are not prepared for that leadership position, which they suddenly found themselves.
Okay, so what's your take on the statement, of course, the breakbacks between the APC and the PDP over corruption fight and allegations?
Well, I agree with you that almost 6 months after taking over power, you should have gone past the stage of lamenting how bad things were when you took over. Because people who voted for you, it is because they felt things were bad and that you are going to improve it. That's why they voted for you. Therefore, what you should be doing is trying to improve what you meant on the ground. Not keep lamenting and lamenting. Otherwise, you will spend this whole 4 years lamenting how bad things were, and it wouldn't do anything. So I think, as my colleague said, I think we have gone past that stage where you should be lamenting how the PDP government ruined the economy. We are expecting to put the economy back on course. And unfortunately, if you look at the trend of the economy since it took over, things have been getting worse. So when things have been getting worse since he was there, he cannot be putting that blame on the previous government.
Okay.
Because if you look at, when I say things have been getting worse, I want to substantiate that. If you look at even oil is our great is our major foreign exchange earner. If you look at the production capacity of our oil refineries, it's been going down. According to a statement by the group managing director, the production capacity, what we produce in September, was they were only producing at 1.4% capacity, almost zero. 1.4% capacity in September. That is quoting the group managing director of the NNPC. And by January, we were producing roughly about at least 32%. The four refineries were producing roughly at 32%. If that has gone down to 1% in September, you cannot blame that on the previous regime.
Now, while economy is one of the things that this administration promised to salvage, we also see that President Buhari said that it would focus on insecurity and you focus on the fight against corruption. What do you make of his performance in about six months now?
Well, you see, all over the world, let me take you down memory lane. Let me take you to America, and I come to India. When President Barack Obama came in, America economy, security, etc., were in terrible state. They're in a mess. In fact, the economy was at the lowest. And he came in, he started finding solutions. He proffered solutions. He went around the world, found allies, brought in foreign direct investments. And what do you have today? America is back on track in less than 5 years. America came back on track. Same thing happened in India when the new prime minister came in. He went around the world soliciting direct foreign investment, despite the fact that India is one of the largest growing economies in the world today. He didn't just sit there. Now, I don't want to criticize. I don't like criticizing government because I've been in government, and I know that the shortcomings and problems of governance. But that is not to say that when you are in power, every government is supposed to come out bouncing. Government is like a football. The first shot, there must be a one-day plan. When you come, when you are inaugurated, you must bounce. They don't drop the ball and the ball falls flat on the floor. No. You must have your one-day plan. On the first day, I can count all over the world, even in Nigeria, some governors, their first day is always marked with activities, whether good or bad. Then they must have one-month plan. They must have 100 days plan. They must have 1 year plan. They must have 4 year plan. And I think in this government, we read it in the newspapers. There were 100 days plans. There were plans for every, in fact, I saw a document. Every day after inauguration, this is what President Buhari is supposed to do. But what do you have? The government came out after inauguration, they bounced and they fell flat. Let me ask you, let's ask ourselves, what is the policy thrust of the present administration? Nobody knows.
How about fighting Boko Haram?
Yeah, well, the Boko Haram issue, yes, I must commend the president that he has done a lot of work in that area. And I think, despite all the exaggerations of the media, to a large extent, we are winning the war. We have the support of the international community now to help us fight this battle, So I believe we are winning the war against Boko Haram. It may not be in December.
Is he winning the war against corruption?
Sorry, Boko Haram.
Boko Haram. But yes. Now, another question. Is he winning the war against corruption?
I don't think so. You see, because corruption is not an issue of you make a scapegoat of one man and corruption is gone. No. You see, corruption has eaten deep into the fabric of the Nigerian society. Right from the gate man in the Ministry of Justice, where that is our own factory, to the registrar, to the local governments. It's just like there's no... Why do you find that it seems there's no local government in Nigeria again today? It's due to corruption. Why do you find that the hospitals, there are no drugs? The classrooms, there are no chalks in schools. It's due to corruption. The governments are not working. It's corruption. So the thing is deep down, and I think we must lead by example. That is the solution. It's not a question of making scapegoat of one person and you think you are fighting corruption. Lead by example. If the legislators say, oh, you can't cut my salary, you can't do this, the executive are coming in. Why don't you set the pace? Why don't you say, oh, this wasted government is too much. If you're a minister, you're entitled to only one backup vehicle. You're entitled to only one vehicle. But what do we have in the states? What do we have in government? A minister has like 16 vehicles in his convoy. A governor has like 32 vehicles, and you're not addressing that. That is the situation as of today. And we voted for change. Where is that change? We've not seen the change.
Okay. And let's go to you, sir. You've actually represented Ogun Central in the Senate, and so you have an experience of what the Senate is like. And now with the recent confirmation of Rotimi Amaechi as Minister of Nigeria, it seems that the Senate is a bit polarized between the APC and PDP. What does that portend for Nigeria?
In fact, if there is one single event that has made Buhari lose credibility about his willingness to fight corruption, it is his nomination of Amaechi to be a minister. Because everybody believes that corruption is the greatest problem in this country. And everybody voted for Buhari because they believed he would spare nobody. And he would really go after all corrupt people and fight the battle holistically. But nominating Amaechi to be a minister, I don't have to be afraid of being sued for libel. He's one of the most corrupt people in Nigeria. America has volunteered information to us. The bank corporation, the bank in Minnesota, actually volunteered information to Buhari that Amaechi has $757 million in an account in his name with them. And they wrote to President Buhari, giving him the details of the account. And yet, the same Buhari is nominating Amaechi to be a minister. When Amaechi was confronted, according to reports, he said the account was lodged in his name by mistake. How do $757 million get lodged into your account, personal name, and you say it's by mistake? What if America didn't volunteer that information? If America has agreed to remit the money back to Nigeria, to President Buhari. So this is not a case of people guessing or his enemies, I think. So when a man like that is a minister, there how much credibility is there that Buhari wants to fight corruption? Okay. If fighting corruption only means going after the people who are not quite in tune with you or going along with you, in other words, against your opponents, and your friends can continue to loot the treasury every day and they go free, then you're not doing better than previous governments.
Okay. Before we go on, I'd just like to open the phone lines. If you want to be a part of this conversation, simply dial the numbers showing on your screen. Tell us what you think about the new dispensation, of course, in As We Build Nigeria, which is a very big project that everyone has a stake in. You just talked about the fact that former governor Amaechi is corrupt, but we have not seen any court declare him corrupt. The legal practitioner,
I told you, please don't skip over that. I told you that the bank volunteered the information, Bank Corporation in Minnesota. Go and find out.
Yeah, but no Nigerian court has declared it, because I think it's the responsibility of the judiciary.
Do we need a court to tell us again? When the bank has volunteered that Amaechi has $57 million deposited with them in his personal name. And they say they are ready to remit the money back to Nigeria because it's stolen money.
Okay, let's hear what the legal practitioner has to say.
Well, I want to agree with you that unless a person is convicted, that's where you're going, that you can't pronounce him corrupt. There's no evidence as of now that Amaechi is corrupt, but we all know that there are allegations against him. And when you have people that are tainted, whose credibility are tainted, you don't bring such people into your government. In this present cabinet, we are waiting. We thought the wait was worth the while for these ministers. And when they came, what do you find? I mean, about 25% of the names on that list are facing one allegation or the other. Okay. They're not indicted yet.
Okay, let's take this call quickly. Hello, good morning.
Hello.
Yes, good morning. Thank you for joining us. Let's know your name and where you're calling from.
My name is Jerry. I'm calling from Kaduna.
Okay, Jerry from Kaduna. Go ahead, Jerry.
Yes.
Go ahead, Jerry. I can hear you.
Yes, I really want to comment on the last speaker.
Okay.
Yes, I said I really want to comment on the last speaker that Buhari has lost his credibility, because for him to appoint somebody like Amechi as part of the speaker, he has lost that credibility already. So he's a failure to Nigeria as far as I'm concerned.
Mm. Okay. Thank you very much, Jerry, for that contribution.
My name is Gerald, not Jerry.
Gerald. Okay, Gerald. Okay. Thank you.
Oh,
thank you, Gerald. Okay.
You see, like I was saying, if you promised change, what is that change? In the past, we have ministers who did not declare their assets, and they became ministers. Now we voted for change. That means those ministers you are going to appoint must declare their assets. In the past, you have people who have charges against them, who have allegations to answer, who have committees set up investigating them. They were made ministers, and people complain. We voted for change. That means you yourself, that you promised the change, should not elect people or should not appoint people who have questions until they sort themselves out. I know that there are charges and the allegations against them, Amechi in his home state.
Mm-hmm.
The charges are ongoing. Court matters are not finished in one day. So you shouldn't bring people that will stain you. It's like you are wearing white dress. You want to wear white dress. You believe you are wearing white dress. And then you put people who have question marks all around you. They're going to soil your integrity.
Okay.
They're going to put a question mark on that battle you are fighting. Okay. And don't forget this.
Let's just call now. Hello, good morning. Hello. Yeah, thank you for joining us. Let's know your name and where you're calling from.
This is Fred from Benue.
Okay, Fred from Benue, go ahead.
Yeah.
Fred, go
ahead. I actually want to talk about the land issue.
Okay.
President Buhari, I don't know whether he has a necessary increase to check the governor with the payment of due balance funds. Because, like the issue of Benue State, the governor did a screening and took whatever he said he received to get this money. On collecting this money, he came back and wanted to conduct another screening. People shouted, why did you do the first screening? And now you want to do another screening after collecting the money. Either you want to put some people out. The pensioners, particularly, like the first thing they were screening.
Mm-hmm.
Then on bringing this money, he now say pensioners are not involved. As I'm speaking to you now, I just heard of one pensioner that just died. By hearing of the news that pensioners are not going to be paid their 6 months arrears and not even their gratuity, because so many of them, you know the issue we face. Somebody that has worked and is tired and is retired and is sick.
Okay.
They don't have money to go to hospital after the previous government owed them 6 months. They've not been paid their gratuity. Now you have assessed this money, you are saying they are not going to be paid. On what ground, after you screened them and took all the records and collected this money?
Okay.
So I don't know whether the president has the mechanism in place to check if the activity of this government about this bill has fallen.
All right. Thank you very much.
Seriously, I think the press should do something.
Okay. Thank you. Okay.
I was going to say that you are trying to say that this thing against Amechi, the one I talked about, is mere allegation.
Mm.
It is not mere allegation. As I have said, the money is there. Amechi has not denied it, because he's been confronted with it. His excuse is that, it was opened, that account was deposited in his personal name by mistake. That was his excuse.
Mm.
And this bank has now offered to refund the money, to return it. So the money is there. Amechi has not denied it. $57 million is deposited in his personal account.
Okay.
Do you call that just a mere allegation? He has not been convicted, he has not been tried.
But
it is not just a mere allegation. The evidence is there. This is evidence for the layman to see.
Mm.
I agree with you, Sharon, and I share the sentiment.
For the layman to see.
But unfortunately, the law is still that.
Yes.
Even if you are caught killing somebody, until you are convicted, tried and convicted,
yeah,
you are not, you know.
Except that the president, that is one of the ways the whole thing is compromised. Because in Nigeria, the president controls the judiciary too, which is not supposed to be indirectly. Indirectly.
While the governors control the judges in their states.
Yes.
Indirectly.
So the president decides who will be charged and who will not be charged. He decides who will be convicted and who will not be convicted.
For a president who has said that he would fight corruption
headlong. Yes, he does. That's what I'm saying, that he said so, we believed him. Mm. But now we cannot believe him anymore. He has lost the credibility.
Okay, you've clearly not answered my first question. Yes. I'm saying that with the walkout we saw the PDP have on the confirmation of Amaechi, I'm saying being a senator, of course, you served from 1999 to 2003.
Yes.
I'm saying, what is the implication of the constitution of the Senate with that particular event that happened during the ministerial confirmation?
Oh, they were very dissatisfied with the confirmation, so to register their protest.
So there are no future implications to that particular event?
Well, I don't know whether the confirmation was done after they had worked out.
It was done after they had worked out.
Well, if it was done after they had worked out, I don't know whether they still had the quorum. It would depend on whether they still had the quorum where the confirmation was done. If they did not have a quorum, then it was that confirmation would be illegal. Because for the Senate to carry out any decision, there must be a quorum. If they did not have a quorum after the workout, then it would be... The confirmation is of that full validity.
And does it tell any... would it tell on the unity of the Senate with this particular event? Of course, since they are also contributory members to this dispensation. And so it's important that they're united to make certain decisions. So what do you...
We can't always expect the Senate to be united, because there are two different parties there, at least two, maybe some other minor parties. Mm-hmm. So we can't always expect unanimity. There will always be differences of opinion, both at the individual level and at the party level.
Okay.
So unanimity is, in any legislature, you can't have no unanimity.
Okay.
Even in the British Parliament or American Congress, you don't have unanimity. There will always be people pro for a particular issue and those against that particular issue.
Okay. All right. Let's pick this call. Hello, good morning. Hello. Okay, we lost that call. Please, when you call in, turn down the volume of your TV set so we don't have disrupting feedbacks. Okay, we have another caller here. Turn down the volume of your TV set. Hello, good morning.
Hello.
Yeah, good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, tell us your name and where you're calling from.
This is Wale calling from Ilorin.
Wale from Ilorin. Go ahead, Wale.
Yeah, I want to reply on what my father there said, Honorable Femi.
Mm.
With due respect, I was wondering why my honorable was criticizing this man's government. If he's on track, he's part of those who have been on track for 16 years of unemployment, corruption, and whatever in Nigeria. So why is he criticizing the government of this man? Let us have a chance. Nigeria has been a government that he has...
Oh, dear. We lost that call. Simply call back to... land with the contribution that you're making. Now, as we go on now, we also see that the House of Reps seems to be in a bit of brickbats, because the APC representative has said that why will the Speaker give the juicy committees to the major, to the opposition party? What does that portend?
Are you asking me? Well, to me, that is a reflection of the very bad state of our politics. And it's a reflection of the fact that people go into government not to serve, but to be served. Not to work for the people, but to enrich themselves. If people go into government to work and to serve the people, there will be no such thing as a juicy committee. Or just like there will be no such thing as a juicy ministry. When people talk of juicy ministries, they're talking of ministries where they can loot a lot of money. And a dry ministry is one where there isn't much money to steal. So as long as people are still expressing preferences for certain juicy ministries, it means they still have the intention of going to stick in that ministry.
If your
mission is to go and work and to go and serve, you should be able, ready to serve in any ministry.
Okay.
Thank you.
I even think this is a confirmation that despite the fact that the National Assembly has a majority as per members, both houses, and these are members that voted for change. Are we seeing the change in the parliament? We're not seeing no change. When people are supposed to serve the people, elected legislators are fighting over juicy committees, that means that they're going there to fester their own necks only. That means nothing has changed.
But the representative raised the fact that if the People's Democratic Party was accused of looting the country's economy before leaving government? And why will the speaker now appoint the same party into these sectors that are so juicy, which would further endanger the change that the APC wanted for Nigeria? Isn't that...
Well, unfortunately, you see, the speaker of the parliament is more than all the members put together, you know. So the speaker, in his own wisdom, decides who gets what. The speaker is not a PDP man, as far as I know. I believe the speaker is a member of the APC, and a very prominent member too. So,
please, Wally, again, I love the call, you're
right. All right, go ahead, Wally.
Yeah, so I just let Nigeria be different. It is almost, if this month is not enough for Nigerian situation to be. Look, Nigeria is a very difficult country to rule. Look at what the minister, the GM of Petroleum said the other time when he stood for minister's training. He said some group of people came up and said Petroleum is going to drop at a low price. That is why Petroleum is cut in the whole country. So many things have been going on. Nigeria is a very difficult country to rule. Give a man a chance. There are some men sitting out there that they don't want him to even perform. He said Nigeria is producing to, well, in January they are producing to amount of percentage. Now they are producing to amount of percentage. You know how difficult it is to rule Nigeria. Look, let's give this man a chance. The issue of Amici that you talk about. I mean, why enter on the platform of a party? APC is a party. And for you to enter on the platform of a party, you have to dance to other people's tone. If Amici was giving to Buhari, he made it clear loud that he might be one of those who is giving to him. Mm-hmm. You cannot expect him to bring all the people in loose. We have to come up with some other opinions too.
Okay.
This is a platform of party. So if Amici was given to Buhari, you expect him, if eventually he was a duty or the court of law, then why have no choice? You have to allow him to go and face it.
Okay.
But he has not been saving this yet. So why should people start criticizing that Buhari has failed in the issue of corruption? He has done that. No, it shouldn't be.
Okay,
anyone,
thank you. Well, we have to go now.
As a Nigerian, you can go to court, challenge and meet if you feel it shouldn't be.
Thank you, Wale. Thank you very much, Wale.
Well, I think Wale made his point that certain people, including Amici, were given to Buhari, given in quote. I'm quoting him now. So if they gave you something, that means you belong to somebody. And I remember when he was inaugurated, the president said, I belong to nobody, I belong to everybody. So now Wale is saying that Buhari belongs to some people, and that's why they gave him Amici.
Okay. Let's hear this caller. Hello, good morning.
Hello.
Yeah, good morning. Tell us your name and where you're calling from.
I'm calling from Aba.
Okay, your name, please.
My name is Chidi.
All right, go ahead, Chidi.
Yes, I'm enjoying your program.
Thank you.
But what I want to ask the Labour practitioner in on your board is about Amici and the evidence they have against him.
Mm-hmm.
The question is, don't you have citizen concerned people that can sue take him to court, take him to court with those evidence you have?
Okay.
Yeah, to answer a question, I believe I don't play in River State, but I know that there is a committee set up, a panel set up by the present governor, Governor Wiki, and I think he's been accused of certain issues, matters of corruption. I don't know whether the money volunteered by the American Bank is included in that.
No, it's part. That's a separate.
That's separate. So he has some charges pending, some allegations pending that have been looked into in that state.
Okay.
But I don't know what happens to those allegations now that suddenly the tribunal has removed Wiki as the governor and removed over 20 of the legislators
really?
In the house.
House.
So you see, I want to argue.
But they still have the appeal court to...
Yes, I do. I know that. Okay. So, individuals have the right to sue Amici, that he has no right to be elected minister based on the information we received from America. But there are procedures. And at the end of the day, that single individual suit may not succeed. It's a very technical aspect of the law.
Okay. Very quickly, Senator Okoroma, I want you to clear the air on what is happening in the Afeniferi now, because we see that there's news in the media about Fashionrote, and of course for you as an appointed Secretary General of the Yoruba socio-political group, Afeniferi, what's really happening?
Well, there is some disturbed equilibrium, I would say, within Afeniferi, which I'm sure the leadership will sort out. It is too early to begin to speak publicly about the issues.
Okay.
Well, I think we should give the Afeniferi leadership and the stakeholders sufficient time to try to sort out the problems. And then after that, the whole public will be enlightened about what is really happening.
Okay. So finally, as a round off now, what do you see in the coming days, or what's happening in the coming days for Nigeria?
Well, I think Buhari should tighten his belt and begin to govern. Right now, he's not governing. As I've said, the economy is getting worse and worse. Look at our stock market. The stock market, since the beginning of the year, has been one way down. And foreign investors are taking their money out by the billions from Nigeria. They are disinvesting.
Well, you know, the president is making different travels to yes. some foreign countries. And so, don't you see that as a very good, positive...
It is the results that matter to Nigerians. The number of times he travels is okay if it's going to yield positive results for Nigerians.
India is willing to give us about $10 billion grant, $10 million grant.
When that comes and it has an impact on the people, then the people will commend it. As of now, what we can see is that there's a lot of disinvestment. Foreign people are taking out their investment from the Nigerian stock market. The economy is going down the drain. The manufacturing sector is in coma. The unemployment is growing up. More than 60% of Nigerian youths between the ages of 20 and 30 cannot find work to do.
So today, that's
and
right.
The percentage is growing higher and higher every day. So these are issues that Buhari should sit down and tackle.
Okay.
It's important.
You
see, I'm concerned with the economy because I have some corporate clients, and at the last time, two of them are relocated outside the country. And that speaks volumes. You see, I know between around 2012, 2014, the United States issued a growth figure, United Nations Development Program. And we see we are growing like 12%. You know, there are foreign direct investments coming in. But tell me, which foreign direct investment is coming in? And a nation, a great nation, without direct foreign investments is doomed. When your president travels to America and he gets a grant or a loan of $1.2 billion, goes to India, gets $10 billion, what does that say? It's bad for the economy because there's no free lunch anywhere. You're being given soft loan. These are monies you have to pay back one way or the other. It's not free. Somebody who's offering you this will ask for this in return. You see, what do we have now? We have people not buying our oil, you know. Is that a fault of the past administration? So my take on this is that the president should look inwards and let us have his policy trust. I've not seen it, and nobody has seen it. The economic trust of it is when a government comes in, you know, this is what the government stands for, rightly or wrongly. When Obasanjo came in, we knew his policy thrust. When it was Yar'Adua, we saw it. Even like Jonathan, we knew the policy trust. Let us see the policy trust of this administration, right or wrong. There must be a political, because without that political trust, that's why you find the stock exchange going down. That's why you find people disinvesting in Nigeria. That's why the dollar will continue to go up, because no money is coming in. So there's a push on the foreign exchange. When Buhari came in, how much was the bank rate of the dollar? How much is it today? I'm not blaming him solely, but he needs to get, he can't do, you see, a one man cannot run a nation. You need people to assist you. You need to assign portfolios.
Hmm.
You can't have floating ministers. It's not done anywhere.
Okay.
You know, so this government should come out and start bouncing.
All right. Thank you very much, Barrister Edwards Ayua Odubeson and Senator Femi Okorum. Mm-hmm. It was really nice having you on the program.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
All right. We have to call it a day on the program today. Thank you so very much for being a part. And as many Nigerians are calling for the current government to bounce, because Nigerians are looking forward to the goods they voted for and seeing the dreams and, of course, the promises the APC campaign promised into reality. Thank you once again for being a part. My name is Omotayo Alo. Have a wonderful rest of the day.
You can now watch Core TV News live from anywhere in the world on our website, www.coretvnews.com. Click on Live TV on our website and watch us live.
And welcome to Core TV Primetime News.
To follow us on Twitter, click on Twitter icon on our website. On Facebook, click on the Facebook and YouTube to see all our previous news production. You can also watch us live on YouTube. Click Core TV, leave a space, then news. Core TV News, a 24-hour news station.